Almighty and everlasting God, who in your tender love towards the human race sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, grant that we may follow the example of his patience and humility, and also be made partakers of his resurrection, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The first word of Christ on the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do."
It is not difficult to see how hatred provides the weak a basis for moral justification. Every expression of intolerance, every attitude of meanness, every statute that limits and degrades gives further justification for life negation on the part of the weak toward the strong. It makes possible for an individual to be life-affirming and life-negating at one and the same time. If a man's attitude is life-negating in his relationships with those to whom he recognizes no moral responsibility, his attitude is life-affirming. There must be within him some guarantee against contagion by the life-negating attitude, lest he lose a sense of moral integrity in all of his relationships. Hatred seems to function as such a guarantee. The oppressed can give themselves over with utter enthusiasm to life-affirming attitudes toward their fellow sufferers, and this becomes compensation for their life-negating attitude toward the strong.
On the steep road to Golgotha, Jesus turns to the women following him in lament and terror. "If these things are done when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?" he says. We are now in the terrible season of the dry wood. this day, this cross, this terror. This is the dry season. We stand before the cross this day, listening to the last words uttered by the greenwood, who has become tinder, dry and broken tinder before our very eyes. What does such a sufferer say as this wood begins to burn? Father, forgive, for they know not what they do. What is it that they do not know, that we do not know? Why might forgiveness be granted to such terrible ignorance? We might think at first that we do not know Christ's innocence, for it is this verdict that is pronounced by the centurion at the end in St. Luke's Gospel. We might think that the stark injustices we commit against the righteous could be pardoned, if only it could be shown that we thought we were in the right, that the innocent were in fact guilty. But is this not the pattern of every sin? That we believe in our own goodness, our being in the right, such that everyone else is thrown into the shade, is night against our unexcelled day. If we think our protection is our conviction of being in the right, we might say that our brief before the Holy God is simply our being sinners. Always, always, we assume our own justification and see matters from our own point of view, our prize convictions. Did we not know we were doing this? That we do this still? Our Lord, who looks on the heart, surely knows our own self-justification and our own sturdy defense that we were only doing what we thought best. True it is that the Lord sees this. It's pitiful selfishness. But is this the ground for the Father's astonishing pardon? Perhaps we do not know the consequences of our own actions. Perhaps this is the reason our guilt should be commuted. And true enough, we cannot see the whole terrain. We do not know the outworkings of a single act, its broad and cresting waves as they reach the far shore. Just this, after all, is what the philosopher Leibniz meant by contingency and happenstance in history. It is retrospection only that allows us a glimpse of the shattering effect of our acts, spilling out into others' lives, into the shape of nations and peoples. To this we are blind, at times shockingly blind to the power of a single deed. But perhaps once again such ignorance seems too broad a ground for divine pardon. To understand this, after all, is to forgive every act. For just this ignorance is the human lot. In the first explanation, the Lord God might forgive every sin, for it is done by those who think they are right. And in the second, he might forgive because no one except the God-man can see the whole inside and out. So perhaps these accounts say not too little but too much about Christ's last word. Perhaps our Lord calls down pardon upon us, for we are ignorant of who we are, rebels against God. We simply cannot believe this of ourselves, upholders of the right as we are. The wide secularism of our Western culture does not simply exist out there in town squares and city streets. It is here, in our chancels and naves. We fall back time and again on our worldliness, our good aims, our converse with the ways of our culture, our times. We do not see ourselves against the dark sky of Golgotha. When we look there, we see in stark outline the very thing we do not know, our defiance of God, our rejection of him, and our rebellion against his ways and his truth. That this could be grounds for the Father's pardon is the astonishing gift of this last word in the Gospel of St. Luke.
Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Christ the condemned, forgive our quick judgments, our fickle collusions with the majority. Teach us the silent strength of truth, for the glory of your love. Amen. The second word of Christ on the cross. Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise.
The Black Christ by County Cullen. God's glory and my country's shame, and how one man cursed Christ's name, may never fully expiate that crime, till at the blessed gate of heaven he meet and pardon me out of his love and charity. How God, who needs no man's applause, for the love of my stark soul of flaws composed, seeing it slip, did stoop down to the mire and pick me up, and in the hollow of his hand enact again at my command the world's supremest tragedy, until I die my burthen be, how Calvary in Palestine, extending down to me and mine, was but the first leaf in a line of trees on which a man should swing, world without end in suffering. For all men's healing, let me sing.
Karl Barth tells us that this scene recounts the founding of the first Christian church. Christ, the condemned, hung between two criminals. These are the two or three gathered together, the ones granted by the Father to be enthroned on Christ's right and left hand when he comes in glory. This is the first gathered community, the righteous for the unrighteous, nailed together on the trees of Golgotha. How should we hear this promise from the first pulpit, the crucified Lord to his repentant congregation? Perhaps we might be tempted at first to think of this tableau as presenting us with contrasting ways of responding to the presence of Christ. One, defiance, taunting, and obduracy. The other, self-accusation, humility, and repentance. The repentant and the unrepentant thief, as our art iconography would have it. And of course, there is truth in this sketch. In one criminal, we hear the echo of the crowd, the Roman soldiers, the clerics as they stride past, jeering, hiding their terror at this cruel death by laughter and mockery. In the other, the power of Christ to teach us the truth about ourselves, that we are receiving only what we deserve. For we steal God's glory, defiling it at every turn. The shadow and the light frame this tableau, and it instructs us still. But we might pause a bit longer before this scene and its congregation, for there is a startling similarity, a doubling, between the criminals on their flanking crosses around Christ. The church, after all, is always this, the wheat mixed among the tares, the sinners surrounding the saints, but the sinners also within the saints. Famously, St. Augustine taught that history itself was the journey of these two societies, two loves, the city of humanity and the city of God, entwined one in the other until God at the end will separate, purify, and judge the two. Then and only then will be the full vindication of the righteous. In just this way, we see the admixture, the twinning of the penitent with the impenitent thief, the one congregation of saint and sinner. Who, after all, cannot hear the irony, an unbidden confession in the impenitent thief's mockery? Are you not the Messiah, he says. Save yourself and save us. Even in our rebellion, our scoffing and pride, Christ works in us the truth. In our denial, we confess his lordship, his stature as Savior. In just this way, the impenitent thief echoes St. Peter at Caesarea Philippi, confession and denial admixed and thrown together. The penitent thief says much the same in his appeal to the Savior. Remember me, Lord, when you come in your royal power. He knows the truth about his state, that he is a criminal. Indeed, he knows that both are suffering for their own guilt. And he knows and confesses what the centurion will confess when the dry wood has been burned utterly to ash, that this man has done nothing wrong. But like the unrepentant criminal, the repentant can only plead with the crucified, remember me, save me when you are seated in royal power. To these confessions and pleas, the crucified Lord replies, today you will be with me in paradise. Just where is this pleasure garden? This paradise that Christ speaks of? A loan word from Persian, a rare term in Holy Scripture, paradise seems the utter inversion of everything that means Golgotha. The noise, the desolation, the infertile rocks, the cruelty and pain, the corpses rotting in the midday sun. Paradise is none of that. How could the dying speak of such a place in the midst of the hellish? Perhaps we are to think on the garden lying not far off from the place of the skull, the garden where St. John tells us Jesus was laid, the Savior now broken in his saving work. Perhaps we are to think of death itself, the end of torment, the release from terror, the stilling at long last of the mocking voices, the smug disbelief. It is the fate of so many in this brutal world of ours that death is the real paradise for them, the only deliverance they have known from the penalty life exacts from them. But perhaps more than any of these, we are to think of this garden as the promise to the first church, to all of us wrongdoers, that to be with Christ, to have him call us to himself in this day, to be lifted high on and through the cross, to be in his presence, the true garden and vine, who makes every haunt of jackals into the Eden of the living God. This is paradise.
Let the cry of the captive come before you, O Lord. In your might, preserve those doomed to die. Christ, the voice of mercy, in our anguish and failure, grant us the vision to turn to you, that we may be renewed in hope and find ourselves safe in the strength of your unfailing love, for the glory of your name. Amen. The third word of Christ on the cross. Woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother.
Canopy from the collection Stranger, Baby, Emily Berry. The weather was inside. The branches trembled over the glass as if to apologize. Then they thumped and they came in. And the trees shook everything off until they were bare and clean. They held on to the ground with their long feet and leant into the gale and back again. This was their way with the wind. They flung us down and flailed above us with their visions and their pale tree light. I think they were telling us to survive. That's what a leaf feels like anyway. We lay under their great awry display and they tattooed us with light. They got inside us and made us speak. I said my first word in their language, canopy. I was crying, and it felt like I was feeding. Be my mother, I said to the trees, in the language of trees, which can't be transcribed and they shook their hair back, and they bent low with their many arms, and they looked into my eyes, as only trees can look into the eyes of a person. They touched me with the rain on their fingers, till I was all droplets, till I was a mist, and they said they would.
We stand now at the midpoint of these seven last words, the final moment when our Lord addresses the crowds and the intimates who stand beneath the cross. These words, though spread across the Gospels, contain within themselves a unitary motion, a single rhythm that echoes the saving pattern of Christ's entire life. They move from an address to the Father for the whole human race, the word of astonishing pardon, to the words addressed to the condemned who undergo torment with him, to now his intimates, his mother and the disciple who remain in terrible vigil on that scorched earth. Soon the crucified one will withdraw into his own last ordeals. His words will be spoken into the terrible silence of that day, a witness to his own ebbing life and his breaking apart in the sacrifice that is his death and his incarnation. That terrible turn will hold our attention all too soon. But in this last moment of his tethering to our earth, to our kind, he addresses those who stand nearby, his mother and the disciple whom he loved, perhaps the disciple John. Here our Lord creates a small paradise for the ones he loved, a green garden where in loss and desolation, even the grief-stricken can find shelter. The beloved disciple gains a mother, the God-bearer a son. This is not the final resting place, not the final paradise of joy and release, but it is the garden that Jesus gives while we are in our pilgrimage, the verdant refuge of family and kin and belonging. He thinks on this, even while stripped of it all. Always, Christ gives the counterstroke to all that we so confidently proclaim. To our rebellion, pardon. To our despair, the word of deliverance and rest. To our isolation, home. To be with him is to have this reversal at the core of our own life. It is even as the lost that we are found. Perhaps St. Mary found it so that day. We have scant detail of Mary's life in the Gospels, a flourishing of narrative at the opening of St. Luke's Gospel, and a somber record of her place at her son's death in St. John's, but in the whole, it is an episodic narrative of trial and of loss. A sword will pierce your own heart too, Simeon tells Mary, and this bitter word is his blessing on her day of dedication. Much she would have to ponder in her heart, her terror at her son's zeal for the Lord's house, her rejection as mother when the fresh disciples become named as Christ's mother and sister and brother, her own isolation as she becomes mother of a convict, spectator to a terrible state execution. It is paradise to be with Christ and to be his own, but this is a garden placed not beyond, but in the midst of the rank weeds of this earth, suffering, injustice, privation, exclusion. Mary knows this as Mother of God. She knows it as the Pilgrim Church, which she embodies and portrays, knows it as only the one who has given her own flesh to make the flesh of the living God can know this truth. It is to her, at the end, that her son relays this final earthbound word, "Mother, behold your son." And to this son, the newly forged kinship, "Behold your mother." Family has been created, a garden planted at the mouth of the grave. Christ gives us to one another. St. Augustine tells us that friendships, our chosen families, are properly and in truth conducted before and through God. Nothing and no one is enjoyed in itself, but only for and in God. This newly founded family, another church in the shadow of the cross, is created by Christ's gift. He is the tie that binds. We will not be spared what Mary and John underwent. This life of ours will meet with its own exactions and loss. We will witness injustice and cruelty. We will commit them. In this journey to the cross, we will stand in vigil and receive, in the persons of Mary and John, the paradise that the crucified will bestow, a family, a kinship, a belonging, one to another. That is the lush garden Christ gives on this, our bare earth.
How long must I bear pain in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all day long? Christ the victim, you felt even the sword that pierced your mother's soul, and you carried her anguish to the place of redemption. When grief threatens our faith and we regret our obedience, lift us up and transform our tears for the glory of your love. Amen. Thank you. The fourth word of Christ on the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me?
In that moment, perhaps, he remembered the things he'd created in 30 years of hammer striking wood. And in his pain, he thought of all creation as good enough, still good.
Now we enter the dark mystery of our Lord's death. This is the great turn in the Passion narrative, the hour, as the evangelist John puts it. We now hear from Christ's own lips the depth and cost of his coming to deliver and to save. These words are wrenched from a dying man, and they are nearly unbearable to hear. We have witnessed in our day the terrible abandonment of human creatures by their fellow creatures, the desolation of war in Ukraine, in Gaza and the Holy Land, in Sudan, and the unspeakable isolation that famine, artillery, bombardment, capture and terror create in those hellish places. We have witnessed the abandonment of the most frail, the most vulnerable, children by their parents, the devastation of failed marriages, the utter immiseration of the destitute, the homeless, the shunned. We have witnessed these cruelties. Perhaps we have suffered from them. Perhaps we have carried them out. But we know the desolation. We know abandonment. Christ's terrible cry is not far from our lips. But there is an element in this last word that we cannot know and cannot undergo. This is the terrible cry of the Son of God as he shouts into the empty silence of a darkened sky. No one and nothing else is this, the very icon and word of God. Come now in flesh to redeem our lot. We cannot know, cannot become what he alone is, the beloved, only begotten of God. Just this makes his cry of desolation so terrifying, so impossible. The intimacy of the Son to the Father, the unimaginable closeness of the incarnate Word to the speaking silence of God, it makes this last word the unthinkable contradiction of the incarnation itself. That this Son should be forsaken is the impossible possibility that St. Matthew and St. Mark record. So stark is this word that it is the only one recorded in those two Gospels, and so unthinkable that the major Christologies of the modern era, of Bard and von Balthasar and Moltmann, are forged out of it. In the terrible silence of the cross, we overhear the roar of this word, and we do not know what to say, where to turn our gaze, how to live in such a world. The beloved Son can call upon his Father, and no reply is given. the heavens that tore apart at his baptism, the heavenly voice ringing out in affirmation, now has fallen silent. At Mount Tabor, where the beloved is transfigured before the amazed disciples, Christ appears utterly alone after the vision ends. But this is a solitude of richness, not desolation, for the Father's voice rang out once again, "This is my beloved, listen to him." But now that the hour has come, the Son hears no voice, receives no ministering angel, has the companionship of no wild beast, finds no legion of angels streaming down the columns of light to rescue, no confirmation of his divine mission, his exodus that he is to perform in Jerusalem. In their place, only mockery, taunting, dicing, ridicule. This is solitude that only the God-man can bear, and it will be the annihilation of his spirit. The crowd that lingers beneath the cross at that third hour echo one another in their derisive cry. He saved others, but he cannot save himself. Let him come down from the cross, and we will believe in him. These are the last words Jesus hears in the Gospel of Matthew. They are the chorus of rejection that this beloved son must bear from the ones he came to save. Yet it is this terrible desolation, this awful silence that is the very saving work he comes to do. Only his cry can pierce it, and it is a cry of every abandonment, every betrayal and rejection, all of it nailed to his cross. He alone can bear it, and it is the sacrifice which is his very life, his death, his end. The darkness that spreads over the whole land is what he bears. And with Israel's Psalter on his lips, he bears it away.
Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Christ of the silence, You inhabit the void and share in our despair. Breathe the consolation of your spirit to the lonely, the dejected, and the forgotten in our world, and draw us from isolation into the abundance of your eternal embrace for the glory of your name. Amen. The fifth word of Christ on the cross, I thirst.
Am I a stone and not a sheep, that I can stand, O Christ, beneath thy cross, to number drop by drop thy blood's slow loss, and yet not weep? Not so those women loved, who with exceeding grief lamented thee. Not so fallen Peter, weeping bitterly. Not so the thief was moved, not so the sun and moon, which hid their faces in a starless sky, a horror of great darkness at broad noon. I, only I, yet give not o'er, but seek thy sheep, true shepherd of the flock, greater than Moses, turn and look once more, and smite the rock.
The living water now becomes thirsty ground. This is what the Gospel of John calls the hour, the moment when all is accomplished. In his deeply moving commentary on the Gospel of John, Archbishop William Temple famously called Christianity the most materialistic of all religions. This last word confirms his verdict. In the cry of dereliction, we overheard the psychological and emotional suffering of the beloved son, the annihilation of his spirit. But in this fifth word, we hear his bodily agony, his material suffering as it approaches its destruction. St. John tells us that this word, too, is fulfillment of Scripture. Like the fourth word, Jesus cites the Psalter. Again, like that word, he enacts the terrible affliction of Psalm 22. His mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and his tongue cleaves to the roof of his mouth. He is already as the dying, laid in the grave for the dead. He has become the living sacrifice, the living dead, and its mark is ravaging thirst. He has become the empty cistern into which Joseph was thrown by his jealous brothers and thrown away. Thirst is a particular agony of the body. No one can live long without water. It is the irreplaceable source of life. Thirst claims the whole body, and in its grip, a victim will drink any liquid that can be found, however contaminated, dangerous, and polluted. The urgency of thirst will drive us on, and we cannot be diverted or rest until it is slaked. Our world is a thirsty one. Though floods have ravaged many nations, drought haunts many more. In my country, water has become the great prize to be secured, and there is not enough. Less each passing year for the livestock, the wild animals and birds, the thirsty crops, and the thirsty human mouths that line up for drinking water for the true staff of life. Across the globe, nations face dwindling supplies of fresh water. We use up every drop we can summon from the deep caverns of the earth. Ours is an arid world. All of us clamor for water, and there is never enough. Sitting by Jacob's well in the heat of the day, our Lord knew thirst. His flesh was weary. His whole body longed for a drink of that ancient spring. That noonday, he knew thirst and knew it met. The Samaritan woman who drew that water for him would receive the first disclosure in the Gospel of John of the messianic identity of Jesus. And he would promise her living water, the surging spring of water that would never run dry, the quenched thirst that would never return. This is the mystical identity of Jesus Christ, the ocean of being, the water of life. He just is the water bearer. And when we come to him, our vessels dry, our inner lives parched, he will descend down upon us like dew upon the mown grass, like rains that turn the desert green and lush with bloom. This is the Lord Jesus Christ. And in his last hour, he is become thirst, parched and fissured earth. This is the very nature of Christ's sacrifice. He is the giver and gift, become the rejected. He, the lover of souls, the scorned and derided. He, the bread of life, now become beggar. The marriage wine, the dry cistern. The eternal spring, the horizonless desert, the thirsty one. Martin Luther called this pattern the gracious exchange, the commercium admirabile. When we take of the Lord's Supper and drink of his cup, his blood, we enter into that exchange, and our richness drawn from his poverty, our deliverance from his captivity, our refreshment from his tormenting thirst. The crucifixion is not a particularly bloody death, we are told, but it is an arid one. To suffocate under one's own exhausted state and to collapse inward from desiccating heat is the lot of the crucified. All of us thirst. But for the beloved Son alone is the thirst that will turn our death to life.
My soul thirsts for you, O Lord, and my spirit faints, as in a dry and weary, where there is no water. Christ, the spring of life, you felt our human need and new want. Grown with those whose bodies are empty, with the world's poor, whole bellies bloat with hunger, and conquer the greed by which we starve our neighbors. To the glory of your name. Amen. The sixth word of Christ on the cross. It is finished.
After great pain, a formal feeling comes. The nerves sit ceremonious, like tombs. The stiff heart questions, was it he that bore? Yesterday or centuries before? The feet mechanical go round a wooden way of ground or air or aught, regardless grown, a quartz contentment like a stone. This is the hour of lead, remembered if outlived, as freezing persons recollect the snow, first chill, then stupor, then the letting go.
What is finished in this hour? This word, the final utterance in the Gospel of John, forces us to ask, just what has been accomplished? What completed? What has reached its goal or end in this terrible death? We are given the solemn assurance at the end of the fourth gospel that all these things were written so that we might believe that Jesus is the Christ and have life in his name. Has this been accomplished, finished, in this crucifixion on Golgotha? We might well pause at this climactic word to ask if this is so. What does our Lord mean to tell us in this, his final word in John's gospel? Perhaps this last wrenching word is a victory cry. That is the verdict of Karl Barth. For Barth, Jesus Christ was called to an unswerving obedience, and this he carried all the way to the lonely cross. Obedience against all temptation, all sin and waywardness, is what was completed finally and without remainder at that fatal hour. And more, Barth held that Jesus was the great penitent of the Bible. Like Luther, Barth taught that Christ was the one great sinless sinner who at the last held fast to the way of repentance. For our rebellion, our blindness, for rejection of grace and commandment, and he held it to the bitter end. This too he accomplished at Golgotha. Christ is enthroned on the cross, and the triumph of his enthronement is heralded in this cry made over a dying breath. This final word is glorious, and it rings out over the place of the skull with far greater brightness than the angelic chorus in Bethlehem coursing through the night sky. Perhaps now we have heard how these things that have been written prompt our faith in Christ and give life in his name. But perhaps we cannot shake the vision of the scoffers and tormentors, the cruel taunters in the crowd that gape at tortured death, the Roman soldiers for whom this is simply another day at duty, or the criminals flanking this crucified one who join in the sneering mockery, all of it ringing the changes on failure. It is finished means, perhaps, this bright future, this shining proclamation of the reign of God, this enactment of healing and feeding and marriage feast, all of this has come down to that terrible vanishing point, the Son of Man condemned and executed by the Judean procurator, a discarded pretender to the throne, a small town rebel idly crushed, and by Roman power simply thrown away. Of course, misunderstanding runs through the whole of the Gospel of John. The onlookers never knew what in fact they were seeing. The interlocutors never grasped the teaching the master will convey. But perhaps the cross is not one more event in that series. Perhaps here on this rocky mound, we see clearly, unmistakably, the final breakdown, the collapse and failure of the mission of this one Son of God. It is finished. We have hauled Christ up before the jury, and we have condemned him to death. It is finished because we are finished with him. Golgotha is the mark of the world's tragic mistake. The king has come in his princely power, and we have taken him for a convict, and we crucified the young prince of glory. Can "it is finished" mean both these things at once? Could a cry from this one slaughtered victim be both triumph and failure, both victory and rebellion, an achievement and a tragic wrong, all these verdicts all at once? It seems that the Gospel of John intends just this doubling, this error and rejection that is also the glorious accomplishment of the Son of God, come not to judge but to save the world. Just this we repeat in our liturgy today: Good Friday, an evil that is at once a good. St. Augustine tells us that God's omnipotence means just this: He alone can bring good out of evil. Our evil is finished here on the hard wood of the cross. Our good has proclaimed his triumph over it, trampling down death by death.
Through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, he has opened for us a new and living way. Christ, the way, the truth, the life, have mercy upon us. The seventh word of Christ on the cross. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
Find me when the journey ends and the sun bleeds into night, and I shall conjure spelts, wild thunder, make bread, rack and roar, tear stories with my hand, let grain shatter and fall. And we shall eat in the dark, mute in wonder, understanding or not, we'll walk softly in the field, as if we still breathed, as if we knew the company of the dead, our dreams trembling as the dawn. And we shall speak as if our mouths are no longer our own, I going on ahead, if that is what you need, learning secret tongues, searching melodies and chords for glorious song.
Again, our Lord turns to the Psalter as life ebbs away. This one Jew has taken into his inner life the prayers of Israel. He has made their cries, their laments and thanksgiving his very own. So close is this inward incorporation that St. Augustine considers the Psalter's Christ's own words, his inner life put down in the words of ancient Israel. To know Christ's mind is to know the Psalter. And when we study these prayers, when we take them on our lips, we examine the very mind of Christ. We think his thoughts. The cry of dereliction springs from the raw edge of Psalm 22. This final word from St. Luke's Gospel, the anguished heart of Psalm 31. Never is our Lord far from the praise and lament of the people of God. We hear from our dying Lord's own lips how Scripture can convey our deepest longing to deliver ourselves in trust to God, the judge of the living and the dead. Alone before his Father, this suffering son hands himself over. He bows before him and submits, yields his whole life into the God whose silence haunted this last day, from the Gabbatha to the killing fields of Golgotha. The life of this Son of Man is costly. Far from the ivory palaces where sweet music pours out from dining rooms and festival halls, the incarnate God ends his life stripped bare, lost among the dead. The Dives stretched out on a crossbeam to be food for the ravens of the air. Surging into Jerusalem days ago on the praises of children, the long-expected one, Jesus is now the outcast, the afterthought, the false king and prophet whose quixotic mission now shudders to a shameful end. This one born to be the consolation of Israel has been proclaimed now the wretched of the earth. Though the hosts of heaven are greater than all the armies of the earth, this crowned rider, going forth conquering and to conquer, is met on this battleground only by jeers, by mutiny and desertion, and the shut-up heavens. Zeal for the Lord's house will soon eat him up. Into this dreadful silence, Jesus breathes his last word. Into thy hands, Father, I commend my spirit. This, Calvin tells us, is the meaning of God's fatherhood. It is not, as we are so often told, some affirmation of divine coziness, a resting place where the little bruises of life are soothed and made whole. Nor does God's fatherhood convey a great reservoir of command, a master architect whose designs will now be made good in our chaotic world. No, fatherhood is none of these placid or wintry ideals. When we call upon God as Father, Calvin tells us, we turn to the one we must call upon, must clamor for, when everything about us is trial, dissolution, rejection, and calamity. We raise our voice as prisoners in a dark cell, turning our plea to the watery light just passing above our heads in the small cleft opened in our fortress wall. We cannot see out. To the passing world, we are invisible. We are wrapped in silence, the wordless cold of the grave. Not before, not in peacetime, but in this combat, this struggle for existence itself, do we call upon God as Father. Out of the deep pit and mire, out of the depth, this cry alone goes out, Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. This is our Lord's last word. He knew, as we cannot, what it is to have God as one's natural father. Up above it is otherwise, but here below to be son is to enter this prison, to be enclosed in this silence, to taste the bitter gall, to be condemned with no reprieve, to be reduced to ash. This is Golgotha, and no desolation reaches this pitch of sacrifice and cost. Yet he calls, yet he commends, yet he names that silence Father, and he trusts in that one utterly, completely, and to the end. This is faith. It is conviction that against every odd, every movement of the forces below the stars, every blasphemy and callous wrong, God the Father remains true, remains good, the just, the deliverer. This is Christ's last testimony, and it costs him just everything. In it, he gives us all.
The souls of the righteous are in the hand of God. Christ, the dead man, you lay there out in the open, inhabiting all our fears of the final end, the end of hope, where we can find no thread of faith. Help us to remain with you, trusting that even in the despair of death, you are still our hope forever. Amen. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Eternal God, in the cross of Jesus, we see the cost of our sin and the depth of your love. In humble hope and fear, may we place at his feet all that we have and all that we are. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance and his form beyond that of mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which had not been told them they shall see, and that which they had not heard they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors.
They shoot out their lips. Reading from the letter to the Hebrews. This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds. He also adds, I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching.
From the 18th chapter of John. Sheathe your sword. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me? It begins. The great sweeping wave, which is the Gospel of John, has now culminated in this garden across the Kidron Valley. It will roar through that garden with lanterns and torches and swords and sweep all of them down to the praetorium, to the guardhouse and the prison, to the Gabbatha, and crest at the place of the skull, Golgotha. We stand at the deep turning of this tide at this very hour. The ocean depths that is our redemption begins its long march to the sea with violence. We should expect no less, since Cain lifted up his arm against his brother Abel. The people of God, our history, has been stained with blood. This is not the only story of our kind. There is much in the history of the people of God that is testimony to fidelity, to courage and discipleship, to self-sacrifice and self-giving, that is also the witness of Holy Scripture. It is not all blood crying from the ground, but it is this, the violence of the very people of God, the ones God has chosen for himself, all of us and our kind, closed up in Christ and in him to the rootstock, to Israel and the eternal covenant. All night we wrestle with God, and against the Holy One we rebel and take to arms. That is the history disclosed to us in the glare of torches and lanterns, lighting the way to betrayal, to treachery, to derision and execution. We stand in that blood-stained garden this night. Simon Peter draws the sword. Even in this fourth gospel, where the beloved disciple lays claim to the man after the Lord's own heart, the intimate of Christ, even here, Peter is the leader of the 12, the spokesman and advocate for the apostles. Just so it is exactly right that he should display the violence that initiates the arrest of his master and Lord. Once again, he speaks for the whole, for us all. He is armed that night. From the last meal and the encounter with the lowly one who kneels at his feet with a slave's basin and towel, Peter emerges with a sword belted to his waist. He is of the world, and he displays his membership in the world we know by his foresight. There is danger in that night, and he will not be swept away in its torrent without a fight. The Holy One has announced himself. I am, he says. And in this acclamation of his deity, the one who is, the soldiers fall down as dead. They have sought Jesus of Nazareth. They have been met by the incarnate God. Again, the Holy One announces himself, I am. And if you seek me, he says, let these others go. At this word of release, Peter draws the sword. He will fight, defend his teacher, defend himself, even as an escape appears close at hand. He cuts off the ear of the high priest's servant, Malchus. Even in this chaos, his name is preserved. So vivid is this memory of bloodletting on the night of betrayal. So begins the work of redemption. So human sinners announce themselves to the holy. The violent bear it away. Jesus turns to Peter, to us all, put up your sword. Shall I not drink the cup the Father gives? Thus the terrible exchange, violence for peace, peace for another kind of violence altogether, begins. There is no disguising the violence in the crucifixion. We might, borrowing the somber phrase of Archbishop Romero, call it the violence of love. The Gospel of John is stunning for its somber clarity about this menace and danger. Everything here has been stripped down to its cruel interior. The pace is relentless, and the evangelist affords us no relief. Nowhere in John do we have the consoling interludes of the synoptics. Unlike St. Luke, there is no healing of the servant's ear, nor do we hear of angels ministering to our Lord as the certainty of death weighs down upon him. Unlike St. Matthew, we have here no rallying of the disciples, all of them ready to go up to Jerusalem with their teacher, ready to die with him. No colorful detail of Caesar's wife and her premonitions. Even the ironic intimacy of Judas's kiss is omitted in the fourth gospel. It is night, and no light shines forth now until the dawn of resurrection day. The night trials in this gospel are stark, simple, ruthless. No great parade of witnesses, no citation of crimes against the temple, no rending of the garments over blasphemy. Simply the stealthy movement back and forth to holding cells and interrogation, the slapping, the binding, the undercover work of ridding oneself of a troublemaker, a threat to the Caesar. The tidal wave of John's passion moves relentlessly past the interrogation before priests and bishops, It sweeps this lonely witness to the truth to the distant outpost of the Roman Empire, the procurator in turbulent Judea. The fourth gospel focuses narrowly and intently upon state power. The King of Kings stands before Pontius Pilate, and the entire trial and verdict turns on the nature of kingship, the law of Caesar in this and every age. There is the customary violence of earthly rule, imprisonment, flogging, contempt, self-serving display of authority, expediency. The mechanism of execution runs its blind course. We overhear in this gospel what Karl Barth called the language of facts. Jesus, Barth said, would hear nothing from his followers but denial and betrayal, nothing from Caesar but time-serving queries about worldly power, its source, and would-be sophistication about skepticism and truth. Nothing from the people of God, its prelates and teachers, but condemnation and cheap vows of loyalty to the state. And nothing from his father but silence. That is the language of facts. And it captures with special power the ruthless sobriety of the Passion in John. No earthquakes, no heavenly dimming of the great lights, no agonized cry of desolation, only the violent, suffocating death of this one Son of God hung between two thieves. This is the cup the Father gives the beloved Son, and he will drink it in the terrible quenching of a dying thirst. Jesus has told our history in his gospel, and we discover in its hearing who we are, children of Cain, in this dark hour. This, John tells us, is the love of the incarnate Son, the love for the world, the love for his enemies, the love consummated at the ninth hour, the hour of prayer in the house of God. It is the costly cure for our blood-stained ways, the only peace that can sheathe our swords. The cross our Lord displays, the cross of our Lord displays violence. It expresses it and confirms it. And in our Lord's holy death, it ends it. His peace, his lowliness, his kingship and reign, they are the final, the only cure for the madness in our blood. Christ's reign has begun this today, though it is not complete. The wars that maim us and reveal our rebellious hearts, they continue this hour across our globe. But the glorious exchange has been made. Christ has commanded the sheathing of swords, and he has given in death his love, his light, his peace. The blood of Abel has stained Golgotha, and we are set free. We have seen this night the glory of God. May it rule our hearts this day and all days. Amen.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you. As we look upon the cross and contemplate Christ's body broken for us, we pray for Christ's body, the Church. Give to her courage to witness to your saving power and to proclaim the way of your redeeming love. Father, bring us into your kingdom. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. As we look upon the nails in Christ's hands and his feet, we recognize the depth of violence with which we continue to treat human flesh and hear the cry of those who thirst for justice. We pray for those who have committed atrocity and recognize our complicity in the violence, oppression, and subjugation of our kin and your creation. Father, forgive us. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. As we look upon the wounds of Christ, we pray for those who are hurting, whose pain or loneliness feels insurmountable, and all who know the agony of the sword of grief. As you walk with us in our days of trial, bring your comfort and restoration. Father, heal us. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us.
Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. O Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, set your passion, cross, and death between your judgment and our souls, now and in the hour of our death. Grant mercy and grace to the living, rest to the departed, to your church peace and concord, and to us sinners forgiveness and everlasting life and glory. For with the Father and the Holy Spirit, you are alive and reign, God, now and forever. Amen.